And welcome back to Let's Play Torment Times of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. I want to go to the next... Well, we got Underbelly of Caravanserai. We came from Circus Minor. We could go do that quest for the lady in here, go back to the Reef of Fallen Worlds, and go in that contraption there. Definitely looking forward to that, but I want to check out Underbelly and Caravanserai.
Of course.
But of course. Still throws me how I can't click on somewhere in the map and then just, like, you know, move there.
Yes.
Yes. Yes?
Yes.
Why? Thank you. Well, look at that thing. It's like a space capsule. Your dominant ties will not stop you from taking any paths or picking any options in conversation. Okay.
Absolutely.
Young man. Young woman. Levy. Are you seeking the Order of Truth? It lies on the far side of this bridge in Government Square. Yeah, we just came from there. Welcome, visitor. This bridge crosses to Government Square. Yeah, this came from there. Who's this child? Aren't the ships beautiful? My friends here won't listen to reason. They'll never survive the endless battle. Lost my lucky ring. You seen it? I don't think so. We're shipping out to join the endless battle. Wish us luck, eh? We couldn't find a captain who'd take us all the way to the endless battle. We'll have to walk part of the way. Ooh! What are these? Cool. Whatever they are, they're cool looking. Almadon. Silver Orphans. Sure, we can look at this thing. This spherical pod is made of a silvery metal interlaced with ribbons of energy. Ooh. Silver Orphans. They come from that pod? Two silver humanoids stand near a small vehicle of indeterminate origin. Their skin has a reflective metallic sheen that makes them appear both a part of and separate from the scenery around them. As you approach, both of them turn to face you. They have no mouths, and their eyes are a fathomless black, reflecting nothing. A name for these creatures rises from memory. Silver Orphans. It may not be the name by which they know themselves, but it's the name used by the Order of Truth. And this guy keeps coming over and looking at them. The Silver Orphans turn to stare at each other for several moments, then the one on the right gestures at you in a complicated pattern. And, well, one or both of them think, "Minds of machines we seek. Know you any?" Okay, so they are speaking to us in our thoughts. Although you can't understand their gestures, you can hear their thoughts. Do you mean machine intelligences? Callister says, "Do they indeed? And what will become of those intelligence if they happen to be delivered?" The Silver Orphans don't react to her words. They stare at you impassively, as though they can't hear you at all. The one on the left kneels, using a foreshortened finger to trace lines and circles in the dust at your feet. Ripples radiate from a point. First a square, then a human eye, then an unrecognizable mass of interconnected dots. The Silver Orphan looks up at you, awaiting your reply. And it thinks, "Any minds of machines, that we may find that which was lost." Well, I'll let you know if I find any machine intelligences. Well, that was quick but brief. That's it. Okay. Amadon. Hail. This robed man turns a golden, bespectacled gaze and winning smile on you. He seems a charming enough sort, but it's clear he wants something from you and is perfectly willing to take it. Politely and with absolute guile, of course. Oh, no, you don't. At last, he says, someone who looks like they can see further than their nose. These sagacites are as observant as rocks. He clasps his hands together, pleading, please tell me you've seen a beautiful girl with purple hair. Her name is Persea. She is my beloved, but she suffers from a madness that causes her to fear everything. She can't stop running from imagined dangers, and I've been chasing her for, oh, years now, trying to catch her and cure her before she hurts herself. And he thinks, imagine, me, a danger to her. Why, I brought her back. Brought her back.
I'll remember that.
I remember tracking her here to Sega's Cliffs, but none of these blind fools can remember seeing her, even though I believe she stayed here for a time. He grips your arm. Let me give you a description so you will know her. She is heartbreakingly beautiful and wears winged hair combs that float around her head, constantly changing the arrangement of her purple hair. Sounds awesome. Please, if you see her or hear word of her, return and tell me. My name is Amadon, and I can be most generous. Hmm. Can you give me more details of her appearance? As I said, she is hauntingly beautiful, with purple hair that floats around her head on winged combs. Her speech may seem confused, so pay no mind to what she says. It is only her madness talking. Once she has returned to me, I will be able to cure her. What sort of things will Persea say when she's raving?
Making a note.
Almost anything, but one of her more persistent delusions is that I am her enemy. Nothing can be farther from the truth. When she is in her right mind, she loves me as I love her, but when the madness is upon her, his voice grows soft. It is more painful than truth can say. He thinks, I would never hurt her. I must make her realize the truth. Simple, if I can find her. Okay, well, that seems to be what he believes. Who knows, maybe he's the one who's mad. How did you and Persea meet? We were at the same grave in the Valley of Dead Heroes, a mutual friend, and in sharing stories of our love for that friend, we found that we were kindred spirits and decided we did not want to part when we left the valley. He smiles wistfully. Odd that a place of death could give birth to something so beautiful and undying. He thinks there is so much truth in that story. Details are irrelevant where there is love. What caused her to go mad? He frowns, thoughtful. It is, I believe, some trauma associated with her birth, her early life. We found that it could be overcome with love and care and certain medications, but even then some lapses occur. It was during the last of these that Persea vanished. I have been on her trail ever since. He thinks, I'm certain she will see clearly as soon as we are together. How do you hope to cure Persea's madness? With love, mostly, but also with certain ancient techniques I have learned in my years of study for the cooling and untwisting of fevered and knotted minds. I am positive that, once I am able to isolate her from the corrupting distractions of the world, I will be able to restore her to her true self. Let me go again. Tell me again how you met. We met in the Valley of Dead Heroes. We were visiting the same grave. Our love grew from there. Remind me what caused her madness. Terrors from her early life that reassert themselves occasionally. They are treatable, but only with constant care. How you cure her madness? I shall cure her with love and patience and isolation from the world and its temptations. When it is just the two of us, it will be a simple matter to calm and untangle her jumbled mind and restore the love we once shared. Now this is interesting, because she's going to say he's her enemy. He's after her. Which may or may not be true. We saw from our initial, you know, click on him, the little intro, that he has guile and he has ways of getting what he wants. So this could be all a fabrication. You just ignore what she said about the time I, you know, beat the crap out of her. That's just her madness talking. Or something worse. Travel safe, friend. So, once we find her, it's up to us to determine who is telling the truth. This synth paddle lies flush with the ground. You can see no way to pry it open. Packed bundles and sealed urns line the area, waiting to be taken into the city or loaded onto a ship. Alright. We got envoys here. Oh, there's stuff over here. Let's explore this square first. Excuse me, have you seen a rather important-looking embossed envelope? I don't have a way to answer you, sir. Hello, yes. On a journey as well, are you? Changing... what? Changing God cultists. Three robed figures stand here, staring at the skies for ships or watching the entrance to Caravanserai for new visitors. He sees you coming, and he elbows his companions. They turn and bow in unison. Revered one, their leader says. We had heard... this guy. We had heard of your arrival in the city, and we thank you for this honor. We believe great things are in store for you. Tell me about yourself. We're the servants of your creator, revered one, the one who brought us your incarnation. He cheats death and changes the course of history. He is the savior of humanity, and we seek to emulate his ways. He thinks, I doubt he actually did everything that's said about him, but his cast-offs are real and powerful. What are you doing here? We look for your creator, revered one, and the comings and goings of other cast-offs like you. Since this is a major travel hub, we had hoped, in vain is generally true, to see your kind come through. And why, here you are. It is a delight to see you, he bows. He thinks, it is the cast-offs that truly interest me. How do they do what they do? Oh, I'm just walking around talking to people. We watch this place and we hope to see your brethren come and go. If the changing God himself came through this place, such rapture. We are the servants of your creator, revered one. I am looking for the cast-off Matkina. Revered one, I wish I could help. I do, but I have heard nothing of your sister for some time now. He bows. Have you seen a beautiful purple-haired woman in the area recently? I'm not sure, beloved vessel, he says, touching his chin with a thoughtful finger. Perhaps I saw a woman matching your description disembarking from an airship not long ago, but I can't say for certain. I do not know where she went, but travelers from afar often stay at Tranquility's Inn. Okay. I have no further questions. Fare thee well. Farewell, revered one. So I guess these all going to say the same thing, I guess. Have you come to see the sight of your creator's triumph? No. It is an honor to speak with one of the children of the changing god. Oh, thank you. Was that Amadon who was just watching us? I thought that was someone else. Harefi merchants. Don't mind my friend here. Being 10 minutes from home makes her grumpy. And, kicky. What are you looking at? Grumpy, huh? Well, there's more to this place. Let's talk to this guard. Memovira guard. A man in a brigandine coat stands in front of the heavy wooden gate. His arms are crossed, his feet firmly planted. You got business with the Memovira? Who's the Memovira? She's the boss lady of the Bloom. Been in charge for about 10 years. Couldn't tell you what the title means, but there's always been a Memovira. His eyes narrow. And if you had to ask that question, you ain't got business with her. What is the Bloom, exactly? It's a monster. A stinking tumor the size of a city, full of veins and cysts and sacs that folk can crawl around inside. Sometimes they lead to... maws. His sunken eyes gleam as he speaks the word. If you give them what they want to eat, they'll send you to another world. Or not, if they decide to feed on you instead. He thinks, I don't even want to open the maw. Poor Resh. Hmm. It's a monster, like I said, a great stinking tomb of the size of a city, full of freaks and killers and madmen. Folk crawl around in its guts, and sometimes they find portals to other worlds, or the bloom just eats them if they ain't lucky. Great. What's on the other side of this door? A road. It goes down the side of the cliff toward the bloom. Nobody gets by unless the boss lady gives the word. Heads down the bloom. Can you tell me anything else about the Memorvera? Nobody crosses her. Not even the council. He waves a dismissive hand at the passers-by. All these poor plotters are scared of her, and that means they're scared of me, too. Go work for the Memorvera, son. That's what my dad told me. You'll never be anybody in this life if folk ain't scared of you. And he thinks, Dad never told me about the bloom, though. I wonder if he even knew. Huh. So the Memorvera kind of reminds me of the Lady of Pain from the City of Sigil in Planescape Torment. I'm sure she's not that similar, but just the way that everyone's scared of her kind of thing. She's this mysterious, like, guardian, right? The boss lady of the bloom, she's been in charge for 10 years or so. Before that, there was another Memorvera, some high and mighty fella, but the boss lady took him down. Nobody remembers his name, or any of the others before him. So you're from Sagus Cliffs? Born in Cliff's Edge. House where I grew up fell into the sea a couple years back, thanks to the Stitcher. May the Black Three bugger him with flaming pricks. He spits. Joined up with the Memorvera and served 5 years in the bloom. Gets in your head, the bloom does. Whispers to you. Tells you to do things, maybe. His eyes gleam. When the boss lady found out, she sent me here. He thinks, threw my mate in the maw. I still can't remember why. I'm looking for a tall, beautiful woman with purple hair. But I wonder if we can go around people in the other districts and ask them about the woman with the purple hair.
I'll remember that.
Ain't we all? That lovesick Carker keeps asking me about his girlfriend, and I keep telling him the same thing. I ain't seen no purple-haired ladies. Truth is, if she did pass through here, she probably stopped at the inn. So if you want to find Miss Purple Hair, that's where I'd start. Miss Purple Hair. Farewell. Uh-huh.
Naturally.
Let's go over here. Tranquility. Folding screens provide the illusions of privacy to room occupants, if not the real thing.
Go.
Book? We got book. Beside the bed is a handsome and well-made night table with a single drawer. A large, open book sits on top of it. Examine the book. The pages of the book are made of thick vellum, and it appears to be an atlas of the region. The book is open to a map that depicts the city of Sagus Cliffs, the Valley of Dead Heroes nearby, a range of mountains to the north, labeled as the Ossifagan Range, and a circular desert farther to the east, marked as the Lost Sea. A thin strip of fabric has been placed between the open pages. A second fabric strip marks another place in the book. Try to judge the age of the book. Natural lore. Based on the condition of its pages, you can guess that the book is about 20 years old. The vellum was probably made from the skin of a herd animal, a young anine, perhaps, or a gallon. Look for names of the nearby settlements. Besides Sagus Cliffs, you see a few other cities and towns. In the city of the Circular Desert, is a large blue dot labeled the Oasis of Mara, or Emra Julios, and a smaller dot immediately next to it, Jerboa. On the far side of the desert is another city, Haraf. The village of Stros Mekai. On one end of the Valley of Dead Heroes is a dot labeled the Necropolis. It's unclear whether this is a settlement or just a site of interest. It's the headquarters of the Army of the Dead. Examine the page marked by the other fabric strip. You see another full-page map, this time representing a region called Egur Kala. It seems to be located somewhere to the northwest of Sega's cliffs, and it's defined by a massive ring of mountains labeled as the Clock of Kala. The mountain range is so perfectly round it was almost certainly engineered by artificial means in a distant past. Several cities and towns dot the landscape, but the largest and most prominent is named Sada Imadu. After a few moments, you turn back to the map of Sega's Cliffs region. So we have no option to take this book. Examine the night table instead. The table is finally made and has a single drawer. Try to open the drawer. The drawer appears to be locked, but you can hear something rattling around inside. The noise is faint but constant, as if the object were alive. Let's break things. Let's attempt to pick the lock on the drawer. Good. I even have to use all my points. After a bit of effort, you hear a satisfying click, and the drawer opens soundlessly.
Making a note.
Inside, you find a small ornamental comb that looks like a jeweled insect. Oh, is this one of the purple-haired ladies' hair clips? In fact, it is a jeweled insect, a biomechanical marvel that is very much alive. The pinchers seek to fasten themselves upon locks of hair, and its wings allow it to hover around the wearer's head. It is one of your things. Several strands of hair are still clutched in the comb's pinchers. They are a vibrant purple. Well, look, not so close to where you're hanging out. You could have come over here and start picking locks, guy. Or smashing things. You seem determined enough. The floating comb and the purple hair match Amadon's description of Persea. It seems likely that she stayed in this very room, and probably not long ago. Yeah. Cool. Tranquility's Rest. Oh, that's an inn they were talking about. Tranquility. Explorer. Let's talk to Tranquility. A woman as tall and graceful as a willow steps forward to greet you. She bows, then looks down at you with warm, gold-flecked eyes. Welcome, she says, to Tranquility's Rest. I am the proprietress, Tranquility. Are you looking for a place to take your ease? As she speaks, a sense of delicious calm comes over you, and you find yourself wanting to agree with her. There is nothing you like better right now than the peace and solitude of a quiet room. Okay, she's charming us. Charm person. In fact, the feeling of calm you feel in her presence is so strong you wonder if it's entirely natural. That's when you notice Tranquility's soothing scent. It must be more than perfume. Perhaps a pheromone of some sort. Tell me about Tranquility's Rest. She smiles. It is the most peaceful inn in Sega's Cliffs, with the most beautiful views. All rooms face outward so that the bustle of the Caravanserai is... I love saying that, Caravanserai, is invisible and inaudible. All you see is sky and sea and the roofs of the city far below you, and all you hear is the breeze. I am the sole owner, and I have been offering solitude, security, and discretion to travelers for 20 years. Yeah, you're going so well with the S's there. The alliteration was great, but you had to throw in discretion. You will never have as sound a night's sleep as you will when you stay here. Tell me again. We just see what she has to say. Tranquility's Rest is an oasis in the sky, a place to leave the cares of travel behind and rest as if in your mother's arms. Here she goes, winning! I provide peace, protection, and privacy. Alliteration for the win. Forgive me for asking, but are you human? She laughs melodiously. No need for apologies. Given my height, it is a natural question. I am indeed human, a human mutant, and fortunate to live in Sega's Cliffs, where that is not a crime. There are very few places in this world where someone like me would even be allowed to clean a hostel, let alone own one. I'm a mutant, and thankful to live in a city that tolerates my kind. My business has flourished here. Elsewhere, I might have been stoned or killed for sport. Your perfume seems to contain some kind of pheromones. Are you manipulating me? She smiles faintly. If calming can be said to be manipulating, I suppose I am, but it is nothing more than that. I cannot control minds or influence thoughts. My scent seems to relax people. That, and another trick I learned, convinced me that opening a hostel might lead to success. What other trick? Could you use your calming abilities to put me into a trance? She looks bemused. No one has ever asked me something like this before. She shakes her head. As interesting a proposition it is, I must refuse, for fear of some complication, or retaliation for the same. Why do we want her to put us in a trance? Alright, let's talk about something else. Happily. I found this hair comb in one of your rooms. Do you know who it belongs to? Or belonged to? She shakes her head. I'm afraid not. We have many visitors here. It could have been any of them. She thinks, how could Persea be so foolish as to leave that here? I might stay here. We need all our intelligence back and stuff. I don't know how much it is. I'd like a room for the night. Tranquility smiles. I'm so pleased, and I'm sure you'll be most comfortable. The price is 20 shins per person. Well, that's half the price of what we had to pay for staying at the camp of the faceless... the changing god. Sorry, faceless god. How much money do we have? Yeah. I'm gonna look around in here first. Where's our money? 72. I'm gonna look around here first and then sleep. You aren't from around here, are you? Neither am I.
Yes, now.
Now, baby. Devices near the head of this bed move to match the current time of day, shading the eyes of their occupants. Pretty neat. Airship captain. Ho there! All that just for ho there. Alright, let's rest. Oh, I don't want to because this guy's gonna die, right? This guy that they're gonna be sacrificing? Let's read this first. Amadan, a man I met at the Caravanserai, is looking for his lost love, Persea. I like Persea. He says that she suffers from a madness that causes her to flee from imagined dangers, and he has been trying to catch up to her for years. Amadan tracked Persea to Sega's Cliffs, and he asked me to help him look for her. I found a hair comb in a local hostel that may have belonged to Persea. Amadan will want to see this. Amadan is certain that Persea stayed in Caravanserai for a time. He describes her as beautiful, with purple hair that floats around her head on winged hair combs. According to Amadan, Persea's madness causes her to believe that he is her enemy, not her lover. One of the Memorvera's guards suggested that Persea probably stayed at the Caravanserai's inn. I should check there for some sign for her. Thing is... maybe I should stay that. Do that. I'm not gonna stay because I want to see if I can stop this guy from being executed. So I don't know who we can find to go over to our side and help us, because the other option is I'll either need to find another way to get the clerk's help or return here with a council member's favor in my pocket. I don't know how to get that. The council tower we can't even get into. Let us go this way. Let's just finish exploring here. Sailors. Sylph. Ugh. Don't look at me so loud. What? Sagus is a great little city. I keep losing clothes here, though. Explorer. I like these fishy guys. Good day, human. We are somewhat busy at the moment. You've got the look of an explorer about you. Am I right? I want your opinion on something. What would that be? I think my friend here and I should explore the bloom, the alleyways, the bars especially. That's what you want my opinion on? Barkeeper. Sylph.